All right, welcome everyone. Waiting for others to join in. Good afternoon, everyone. I think few more will join in. How was the test experience? How was the test? Challenging, okay. So anybody got let's say good experience but dissatisfactory scores? Yeah, I told you, right? You might have seen the scores of the top few kids. But then don't go by their scores also, because nobody is invigilating the test, right? So you never know who is taking it honestly or who is, you know, giving into the temptation of looking at the solution in the internet, right? So, but then assuming that each one of you have done it honestly, which is a very tough assumption, but anyways, we should not make any comments on that. So, in this test, if you're close to 200, you're doing really, really well. Okay, so don't worry about all that. But then if your score is near to 100, it clearly shows that you haven't done the assignments properly, 100 or below 100. Okay, so your scores in these type of tests will fluctuate very, very hard. All right. If you are honest with yourself, you have done the assignment properly each and every week, you are doing that. Pooja, mute yourself. Pranav, mute yourself. So each and every assignment, if you're doing it systematically, honestly, you'll be doing exceedingly well. But if you're like one of those kids who thinks that I can prepare, let's say, you know, 1 or 2 days before the exam, these are not those kind of exam wherein you can prepare 1 or 2 days and hope to do well. So I hope you got a learning here that the preparation for these exams is continuous. Okay. Continuous. You have to keep on working hard and keep on doing the assignments. And then only at the end, the result will be satisfactory. Okay. And I'm sure many of you have learned many things during the exam, which is beyond the, you know, just concept. For example, if you're not getting continuously 3-4 questions right, then you will feel that, oh, timer is running, what to do, whether to go in physics or maths or to do chemistry first. So that kind of problem happens or not? Have you faced those kind of issues during the test? No one faced. Okay, yeah, there are few. If you have not faced those kind of issues, something wrong with you. Okay, all of them faces such issue. Time is a big factor in the exam, all right, which we ignore. when we do the assignment and when we solve problems sitting in a table, we have a smartphone, we chat with people, we don't care about the time running in. But then in exam, suddenly time comes in and starts ticking. And then the game begins, and it will lead to many problems. And I'm sure that you have you done any silly errors in this exam? Could not decide whether to attempt or leave question where I have doubts. Okay. Yeah, you might have seen that you have done many silly errors also. Okay. So apart from concepts, forget about, you know, whether you know something or not. Apart from that, I'm sure that you guys might have lost at least 20 to 50 marks on just these kind of issues. Like, not managing the time properly, multiple silly errors, getting panicked in the middle of the exam. So all those things will contribute to 20 to 50 marks. Fine. So, and they will go away only when you take a lot of tests. Okay. All right. Fine. So, and there was one question, I think question number 18 in physics, there was, two options have the same answer given. And that question is a bonus mark. And this happens in the actual exam also. There are some errors in the actual exam wherein if it is found to be wrong, people are given bonus mark on that. Now, if you are like, you know, that how come I'm not getting the answer, you spend 2-3 minutes, 10 minutes on that one question itself, you're losing too much. Okay. That question itself may not be correct. So you have to learn to let it go and move forward. Fine. I didn't understand when to take risk and take a guess or to leave a question. Okay. That is a common thing, and everybody has their own risk appetite, and the way you should take the risk also, nobody can teach you, okay, that how to take risk. It is your own appetite. Like on that day, if you are like between option A and D, you want to pick one, but you're not sure, but you think that A could be correct. Okay. So you have to reason out within yourself, which one to pick. I can't say that pick D or pick A. If you want to take a risk. Okay. I usually say that, unless you are reasonably sure, don't take a risk. I will not take risk. I will just go by whatever I know. Okay. In chem, one of the molecule. Okay, fine, sir. We view the result again. Yes, you can view. Highest mark as per the result is 266, I guess. You can check. You can click the results and it will be there. Integer type, you should attempt everything because there is no negative mark, isn't it? So you should attempt all the questions. And, but then from 0 to 100 or 0 to 1000, there can be any integer as a correct option. So that is why there is no negative marking. So if you don't know what is the answer, chances of you getting right in the integer type is very, very less. So guessing won't help actually in integer type. But anyways, you should guess because there is no negative marking. Okay. Any other doubt and any other thing that you want to discuss with respect to exam taking strategy? Anything that you... Okay. All right, guys. So what is a good score? I told you, right? Near about 200 is decent. And I'm sure that those who have been doing the assignment and homework systematically would have got near 200 irrespective of whether you consider yourself very integer, very intelligent or not so intelligent. You would have got 200 easily if you would have followed the assignments and everything. Okay. Which section to do first, second, third? It is totally up to you only. Okay. If somebody tells you that there is some magic formula, is fooling you, and I don't want to fool you. So it is your own comfort level. Ideally, what people say is that I mean, there are multiple strategies, okay? One strategy is, one strategy is to attempt the, your favorite section first. Favorite as in which you are good at. And the surprising thing is the toppers who are toppers in the JE exam, top 100, top 200, or top 500 also, their favorite subject is chemistry. The reason is they can finish that section in 30 minutes and very accurately because that doesn't take up a lot of time. So that gives you confidence that you have 30 minutes extra. And then in between you slice, in between you put your, mediocre subject, or you can, people say that you can take math in between because that takes relatively longer time. And then you take physics. That is what people say, majority say, but majority need not be correct here. I've seen many cases in which people are going sequentially and they are able to do very well. It is totally up to your comfort level. And one more strategy. Hold on. I'll answer. One more strategy, which I have never tried, but I have heard many a times that top ranker, the single digit rank, All India rank 1, 2, 3, all those guys, what they do is that they don't think that one section is physics, one is chemistry, one is math. They consider the entire paper as if it is one subject. Okay. And they, what they do is that, they have multiple passes to the paper. They'll keep on looking for the easy questions to solve. So first pass, they'll scan entire paper and they'll just click question number 1, 2, 3. They'll find, oh, question number 3 looks very simple. So let me solve question number 3 first. So they'll solve question number 3. Like that, they keep on finding the simple questions till the very end. So all the simple questions are exhausted. Okay. Then they again go through the entire paper, look at the next difficult type of questions. They solve them. And while doing multiple passes, they have the map in their head that, okay, fine, there was one question which I could solve, but that will take a little bit longer time. So they mark it also on the piece of paper that question number 5, I have to go back and do it. Okay. So like that, the top rankers do, top 10, top 15 rankers, but that doesn't come just like that. Okay. So that is another strategy. How many of you think that they have left some easy questions in the exam? No one. You always think after the exam, when you look at the solution, you'll feel, oh my God, this one was very simple question and I should have tried it. Okay. That should never happen. Even if you are, let's say, attempting, let's say, physics first. So scan the physics paper, find the easy questions of physics and solve them. All right. First, you solve easy question. That is like thumb rule, okay? That should never be this thing. Whether the question is easy or difficult, they have the same marks. So what you should do, do the easy ones, leave the difficult ones to the later time, then do the easy ones of chemistry, then do the easy ones of maths. Then you can pass it all over again, fine? And the most difficult ones, just leave it. Why you have to solve it? Why you have to spend time in it? Anyways, you're not aiming for 100% marks. 100% is 300, right? You, right now, your aim is to maximize your marks. Maximization happens when you get a lot of marks for lesser amount of time. And that will happen only when you attempt the easy ones first. Okay, so all of these things you should keep in mind in the next test. That will happen about a month from here. And it may happen that whatever we have done till that point in time, from day one, everything will come in that exam. Okay. All right. So all of you were there in the bridge program. Is there anyone from this batch who was not part of bridge program? Anyone? Okay. So, all right. Okay. Namrata, Kaushik and Pooja, you joined little late. Okay. So, but then have you watched the videos of the bridge program? I have circulated those. Have you watched the videos? Okay, good. Pooja and Kaushik, you? All right. So why I asked that, because today we are going to do motion in a plane, and the vectors is the integral part of it. And vectors we have already done in great details. Fine. So I'm assuming that you guys have gone through the vectors videos at least, right? Kaushik, you've gone through the vectors, right? All right, great. So good to know that. And today we'll start this chapter. So let us continue. And yes, don't get disheartened by the marks you have got. You know, it is very easy to get disheartened by that, because I can understand few students whom you think that would not have been so much ahead of you. Suddenly you'll see their marks are at least 100 point away. So there can be multiple reasons for that gap, and that gap, how fast it has created, that fast it can go away also if you are ready to do work systematically. Okay, and never prepare for these tests 1 or 2 days before. It will not help. Okay, you have to continuously keep on working hard. Fine, enough of Gyan. Let's do that chapter right on motion in a plane or 2D. Okay. Now, motion in a plane is a logical extension to the previous chapter. So you will find that it's very, very simple way they have extended whatever we have learned in motion 1D. Same thing they have extended to motion in 2D or motion in a plane. So there will not be a lot of theory in this chapter. This chapter will be full of numericals. So for example, I'm not going to tell you that V is equal to U plus AT for, I'm not going to derive that again. That we have done in motion 1D. I'll just tell you how to use V is equal to U plus AT in motion in 2D. That's all. Okay. So this chapter can be divided into three chunks. All right. The first one is projectile motion. And I'm sure you guys have attended the bridge program, and those who have not watched the videos, we have done projectile motion. You know, we have done up to the level of, you can say CET, or up to the level of starting of the mains level difficulty. So we have already done the school level projectile motion. So you will not face any trouble if your aim is just to finish the school curriculum. Okay. So when it comes to projectile motion, I'm going to again brief you up a little bit, and then we'll directly jump into the problem solving of different types of situations. Okay. Then we have circular motion. Okay. Circular motion is another scenario that is motion in 2D and or motion in a plane. So we are going to study how to analyze the circular motion. There might be cases when the object is revolving with constant speed, or let's say its speed keeps on changing with time. Okay, what is the acceleration? Whether I can use V is equal to U plus AT, all those things we are going to study in the circular motion. Okay, and then we have relative motion in 2D. So relative motion in 2D is no different from relative motion in 1D. Whatever we have learned in the previous class about the relative motion in 1D, exact same way we are going to analyze relative motion in 2D. but just that here we'll be taking components. All right. So you will see how we can analyze it. All right. Now, now that we have to start the chapter, I can take either of these three. Okay. Now projectile motion, we have already covered little bit. So we will start from circular motion. Then we'll be doing relative motion 2D. And after that, we'll get into the projectile motion. Fine. So write down the circular motion first. Circular motion. You can speak also whenever I ask you to speak or ask any doubt. Please speak. It's not that I'm, you know, I'm against you speaking in the class. You can talk, but not in between. While I'm speaking, don't start speaking. Fine. So tell me, what is circular motion? Anyone? Motion about a fixed point, motion about a pivot. Okay. Acha, tell me, what is circle? What is circle? Circle is what? First define what is circle. Locus of all points that is fixed distance from the point. Okay. All right. So basically, if you draw a path, if you draw a, let's say, a line, a curved line or a path, so that every time you are at a fixed distance, you are at a fixed distance from a point, then it will trace a circle. Okay. Now, let me draw a circle. It's a circle. Okay. This is a center. So whenever a circle is given, center should be given and radius should be given. So a particle, if it moves along the circle, we call it as a circular motion. Now tell me, does this point need to be fixed? Center needs to be fixed or not? Can center move? Can center move? Why it has to be fixed? Do you, Acha, when the earth is revolving around the sun, is the sun fixed? Sun is not fixed, right? Correct. The relative distance has to be fixed. Relatively, it has to be fixed. Fine. Relative to the center, the distance should be fixed. Center can be moving. Okay. But then that will create a complicated scenario. We are not going to discuss that, but I'm just throwing the idea to you that the center need not be fixed. One more example I'll give you is that, the fan is revolving around, let's say on top of your head, fan is revolving. So fan is moving in a circle. Every point on the fin is moving on a circle. Let's say this is the fan. Okay. Each and every point is moving in a circle. Yes or no? So whether you talk about this point, that point, everything is moving in a circle. With respect to this point, now tell me whether the center revolves around a circle with respect to that point. Is that correct? Is center moving in a circle with respect to the tip of the fan? Distance is fixed, right? It is moving in a circle. It is moving in a circle, but you are not able to see it. Why are you not able to see it? Because your position with respect to center is at rest. So you'll not feel as if center is moving. Okay, but if you stand on the fin of the fan, then with respect to you, fin will be at rest and center starts moving in a circle with respect to you. Relative velocity will be circular motion. Okay, fine. And these kind of concepts will be clearer with time. Right now, I'm just throwing ideas to you and telling you that in a circular motion, center need not be fixed. Okay. All right. So now when we talk about the circular motion, we'll be talking about one more thing, as in how to analyze the circular motion. So there will be some parameters in a circular motion. Tell me, what are those parameters? If some object is moving in a circle, what are the parameters that you should know to describe its movement? Radius is no. Radius, center, and speed. Is that it? No, circumference will be known by when I tell you that radius is there, circumference you can find out. Okay. Okay, somebody is saying that we should know whether it is going anti-clockwise or clockwise. That is also fine. You should know which direction it is moving, right? What else? Time is a variable which has nothing to do with the motion as such. Okay. Velocity, right? Velocity you should know. Which direction the velocity is? When particle is moving in a circle, which direction is the velocity? Let's say over here, which direction? Where it is trying to move? Along the tangent. Everybody is clear, right? Along the tangent. Everybody is clear. Okay, so there will be tangential velocity. Like this. Okay. Now over here, which direction the velocity will be? At this point, it will be upwards because tangent is upwards, isn't it? So this is upwards. On top, it will be this way. Over here, it is like this. Now, is the velocity constant? Even if the magnitude is constant, if magnitude of velocity is constant, can I say velocity is fixed? Velocity is not fixed even though the speed is constant. Fine. The reason is it continuously changes its direction. Continuously changes direction. Getting it? So, even if, write down, even if speed is constant, then also velocity keep changing. As direction is changing. Okay. Fine. Now, if velocity keeps changing, will there be an acceleration because of that? If velocity keeps changing, there will be an acceleration or not? There will be acceleration, right? What is the formula for acceleration, everyone? If velocity keeps changing, acceleration is? Delta V by delta T. Now, this is average acceleration or instantaneous acceleration? This is average, right? This is average acceleration. How to find the instantaneous acceleration? At a particular moment, what is acceleration? How to find that? Take delta T tends to zero. When we are talking about a very small time interval, okay, then the average acceleration becomes instantaneous acceleration. Okay. Now let us try to find out what is the value of that. Okay. And by the way, the magnitude of speed is given. Speed is, let's say, u. Okay. It is constant because speed is not a vector. Let's try to find out the acceleration from this formula, delta V by delta T. Okay. So I'll erase this. All of you have to draw these diagrams very neatly. You're doing it for the first time. Probably you'll not do it ever again. So do it properly the first time. Draw a nice circle like that. You'll not be able to draw that nicely. But anyway, try it. Let's say these are the two points. Point number one and point number two. Okay. It is going with constant speed. So if I draw the velocities, it will be like that. Right. These are the velocity directions. The magnitude of these vectors, which you can say the length vectors, the length of that is u only. So let's say the velocity over here is v2. This is vector, okay? V2 vector is different from v1 vector. Magnitude is u only for both of them. Okay, now if you draw V2 and V1 together, let's say you draw here, this is V2 and this is V1. Just bring the vectors parallel to itself, move it, and just make sure their tails are touching each other. This is V2 and this is V1. All of you have understood the vector diagram here, how we have drawn, everyone? Everyone understood this? I have taken V2, moved it parallel. I have taken V1, moved it parallel and made it look like this. Okay, so that I can find out V2 minus V1 because I am using triangle law. So I have to create a triangle to find V2 minus V1. Everybody understood this, right? Okay, now tell me, where is V2 minus V1? Where it is? Parallelogram, where is parallelogram? No need to draw parallelogram. In this triangle itself, can you find out where is V2 minus V1? This is V2, where is minus V1? Is V2, where is minus V1? This one is minus V1 or not? Opposite of V1 is minus V1, right? We change the direction of V, so this is minus V1 now. Okay, change the direction of V1, you'll get minus V1. Okay, so V2 minus V1 is a sum of these two. It'll be like that. So this is V2 minus V1. You can call it delta V. Everyone is very clear that this is delta V. You can ask doubts. Don't just sit if you're not able to understand. Delta V by delta T is the average acceleration. So the direction of acceleration is in which direction? V2, V1 or V2 minus V1? V2 minus V1, change in velocity, which is what? It will be like that. Okay, it is like this. So now I have to write what is delta V in terms of speed u. Okay. If this is theta, okay, if that is theta, how much is that angle? Everyone. What is the angle between V2 and V1 if this is theta? Extend this line. This is the angle which I am asking you what it is. No one? How much is this? Tell me how much is that? This angle is what? 180 minus theta, right? Because this is 90, this is 90. So this has to be 180 minus theta. So this angle should be theta, right? So this is theta. Okay. All right. Now tell me, is the triangle, this triangle O12, is it similar to the triangle PQR? Explain the last part. Last part was this. This angle is 180 minus theta. So this angle is theta because the total angle is 180 from here to, this is a straight line, right? This is a straight line. So it is total 180 degree. That is 180 minus theta. So this is theta. And that is the angle between V2 and V1. So I'm putting it at theta here. Okay. Tell me, not congruent. I'm asking you whether they are similar. This triangle, is it similar to that triangle? Both are isosceles triangle or not? Both are isosceles or not? O12. Two sides are equal, radius and radius. PQR, two sides are equal, magnitude is speed, which is constant. PQ, length is speed, PR, length is speed. So both the triangles are isosceles. This angle is same. So even these two angles should be equal. So they are similar triangles. Fine. Now, can I say that PQ, okay, I'm using red to use this one. Can I say PQ by PR? PQ is a length, okay? PQ length divided by PR length is equal to 1-2 length divided by O1 length. Can I say that? Everyone? No. Why no? The two triangles are similar. The ratio of sides, Pratik. O2 and O1 are both same. O2 and O1 both are radius only. It doesn't matter. Okay? Aditya, is it fine? But 1-2 should not be there, right? 1-2 comes instead of PQ. Oh, wait, 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 wait. Sorry, sorry, sorry. Yeah, you guys are correct. See, some of you have identified it. QR divided by PQ, this is what I meant, is equal to 1 2 divided by O2. Now is it fine? Corresponding ratios. Okay, sorry for that confusion. QR, can I say, is magnitude of the change in velocity? QR, right? It is magnitude of change in velocity. QR is delta V. So magnitude of delta V is that length QR. So delta V magnitude divided by PQ is what? Length of PQ is what? Anyone? Speed. U only. It is speed, not the radius, speed. Now tell me, if speed is u and delta t is very small, if delta t is very small, what is the length 1 to 2? What is length 1 to 2? One to two length, r d theta. Okay, that's fine. One to two distance is covered with what speed? What is the speed with which one to two distance will be covered? U only. See, if delta t is very less, arc length will be like a straight line, isn't it? Theta is very less, arc length is very less, as delta t is tending to zero. So the arc length 1 to 2 is like a straight line. So if speed is u and time is delta t, so what is the distance 1 to 2? U delta t, isn't it? This distance 1 to 2 is u into delta t if delta t is very small. All of you able to understand this? Everyone, please type in yes or no. No? Okay. Okay, listen here, listen, listen, listen. Fine. So if delta t is very less, the particle is moving in a circle from 1 to 2 like that. Okay, this is arc in which it is moving. So this arc length, the length of the arc, can I say it is speed into delta t? That you understand? The length of the arc in delta t time, if speed is u, will be u into delta t. With that speed, it is covering constant speed. Okay? So u into delta t is arc length. And if delta t is very small, the arc length will be very small. Right? So if arc length is very small, then the straight line and the arc length distance will be equal. That is why 1 to 2 distance is same as the length of the arc, which is u delta t. Now is it clear? Vaibhav, is it clear now? Shreyas? This is very important. People ignore it. Okay? They just mug it up for the derivation in the school. They don't understand it. But I am explaining it slowly so that you can get how centripetal acceleration comes. U delta t is 1 to 2. That divided by O2 is what? O2 distance is radius r. Okay. So from here, you'll get magnitude of delta v divided by delta t equal to what? U square by R. Okay. All of you have understood probably. This is the magnitude of the acceleration. Now, if delta t is very small, which direction the acceleration will be? What do you think? Direction of acceleration will be? Towards the center, towards the center. You can see here, direction will be towards the center. Okay. Direction of centripetal acceleration will be toward the center. Why are we taking mod of delta v? Because we are taking length ratio, right? Length cannot be vector. So I'm taking magnitude of that. Okay. QR cannot be a vector. It is length. That's why I've taken mod. Mod of a vector is a length of the vector. Anyone has any doubts in this one? Whatever we have done till now. Clear. Okay. Fine. R is radius. R is radius. This is the, I'm coming to that. This is the centripetal acceleration. This is centripetal acceleration. Okay. Yes. Instantaneous. At every instant, this acceleration will be there. Okay. Fine. All right, so now that we have got the value of acceleration, let's look at the scenario in a little bit more detail. So till now, we only considered the velocities. This is the direction of velocity here. This is the velocity. Okay. That's the velocity. These are the directions of the velocity. Now, can you draw the direction of accelerations everywhere? Speed is constant. Previous page you want to go to. Done. All right, so all of you draw the acceleration at these points. Everyone. Done, everyone. This is the center. Where will the acceleration at this point? At the bottom point, acceleration will be upwards towards the center. Here, towards the left. This one, bottom. This one, this side. Okay. This is the acceleration. Now, one thing is very clear that if an object moves in a circular path, there must be an acceleration towards the center. Okay. And what creates the acceleration? What you need to create acceleration? From where acceleration comes? Force. There has to be a force. Okay. So if a particle is moving in a circle, what kind of force should be there? Which direction the force should be there? Everyone. There should be a force in the direction towards the center. Okay. Towards the center, there has to be a force to create the acceleration towards the center. Fine. So that is essential. Everything else can be compromised with, but a force toward the center is a must because there must be an acceleration towards the center. So now you think of any circular motion example, any example. Earth revolving around the sun. Sun is trying to pull towards itself continuously, right? Then you tie a stone with a string and rotate it. String applies a tension force towards the center when it is moving in a circle, right? So every example that you take, there will be a force to create this centripetal acceleration. And that force is called centripetal force to create this centripetal acceleration. Okay, but that will take care of in laws of motion chapter. Right now, I'm just telling you for your knowledge. Okay, now tell me, is acceleration constant? If we have a point mass, what do you mean? Point mass can't rotate on its own. It has to take a bigger circle. Is acceleration constant, everyone? Magnitude of acceleration is constant, but is direction is constant? Is direction constant? Direction keeps on changing, right? So if direction keeps on changing, how can you say the acceleration is constant? So when we talk about vectors, vectors have two things, direction and magnitude. Both you have to see, fine? So in a circular motion, in the simplest of the circular motion, in which speed you are taking constant, even there also, the acceleration is not constant and velocity is also not constant. So can you use V is equal to U plus AT here? I cannot use directly, okay? Because acceleration is not a constant, right? So one thing is very clear that magnitude of the velocity and magnitude of the acceleration, you don't need to track. You already know it is fixed. Speed is u and acceleration is v square by r. So you only need to track what? If you want to analyze the motion, you only need to track where it is. Okay. Where exactly the point is. If you find the point is here, okay, if you know that after some time the object will be here, you'll know that acceleration will be in this direction, velocity will be in that direction. Okay, so you only need to track the direction where it is. And what is the best variable to track the direction or the location where it is in a circle? Can you think of any variable to track the location in a circular motion? Angle, right? It is angle only. So if I know at what angle the object is from its initial point, I know everything about it in a circular motion. Fine. So that's the reason why circular motions are best analyzed in terms of angle, okay? Not in terms of position. Positions or rate of change of position, which is velocity, or rate of change of velocity, which is acceleration, works best in a linear kind of motion. In a circular motion, magnitude is already known to you. You want to track the angle where it is right now. So you should use angle to find out, you should analyze angle. You should track angle, not the position. Now let's see how we can track the angle, okay? So suppose there is a circular motion, okay? The object goes from this point to that point, okay, with speed u. This angle is, let's say, डेल्टा थीटा रेडियस इज आर. ओके, दिस इज द आर्क लेंथ. आर्क लेंथ इज लेट से डेल्टा एस. ओके, सो डेल्टा एस इज हाउ मच? आर्क लेंथ इज हाउ मच इन टर्म्स ऑफ आर एंड थीटा? Theta need not be small. Theta need not be small. What is the definition of angle? You know, right? Arc length divided by the radius is theta. Okay. So delta S is R delta theta. Fine. So this is the first relation. If you're tracking angle theta, r into theta will be the distance covered by the particle in the circular motion. Okay, fine. Then if you divide delta s by delta t, this is equal to r, let's say delta theta by delta t. Okay, now if you put limit delta t tends to zero, what do you think left hand side is? What is left hand side? Distance covered per unit time, where delta t is very less. Instantaneous speed it is? Is it speed or not? Distance by time it is, right? It's a speed. Okay, let's say speed is u. So u is equal to r into d theta. This delta theta by delta t can be written as d theta by dt. And d theta by dt is referred as angular velocity. The symbol is omega. Okay, so we have these two relations. If you tell me what is angular velocity and radius, I can tell you what is the speed. Okay, because angular velocity into radius should be equal to speed. Fine, everybody understood, right? If you differentiate speed, what you should get? Why change in theta? Theta will be changing, right? It will keep on moving like that. Theta will keep on changing. What is the issue? Quickly type in or you speak, Siddhant. Oh, no. Theta is the, it is like this. Initially, the particle is here, let's say. As it moves, theta changes. First, this is theta, then that is theta, this is theta. Theta keeps on changing. From zero, it has become 90 degree. If it is 90 degree, particle will reach there. Okay, so you're tracking how much angle it has made from its initial position. Okay, now what is du by dt? What do you think this should be? Will it be centripetal acceleration? Du by dt, rate at which speed is changing. This is not rate at which velocity is changing, by the way. This is rate at which magnitude of velocity changes, which is speed. What it is? Omega is angular velocity. Yes. Omega is angular velocity. What is rate at which speed changes? Everyone, rate at which speed changes. So basically, you're changing the changing this. Right now it is this much. After some time, the velocity will increase this much. After some time, velocity will further increase this much. And then, you know, velocity keeps on increasing, but it remains tangential. Magnitude of acceleration? No. अच्छा टेल मी वन थिंग, इफ स्पीड वुड हैव बीन कांस्टेंट, ऑल ऑफ यू लिसन, इफ स्पीड वुड हैव बीन कांस्टेंट, ओके, देन इफ आई डिफरेंशिएट स्पीड व्हाट विल आई गेट? आई विल गेट जीरो, आई विल नॉट गेट एक्सेलरेशन. Speed is magnitude of the acceleration, magnitude of the velocity. Magnitude of velocity will be fixed if speed is fixed. Fine. But suppose speed is not fixed. Speed is changing with time. Then if you differentiate du by dt, you will not get zero. Then what it is? What it is represented as? It is the acceleration which is in tangential direction. Radial acceleration will be always u square by r. This will always be true. Okay, if tangential acceleration is u at any moment, tangential acceleration is u at that moment, radial acceleration will be u square by r. That will not change. But if u is changing, apart from radial acceleration, there will be tangential acceleration as well. Okay. This will be equal to r times d omega by dt. This is at, it can be written as at, this is equal to r times alpha. Okay, alpha is a symbol for the angular acceleration. Okay, alpha write down is angular acceleration. So you know, you should not be surprised at these values here, because when we discussed about the linear variables, okay, when we discussed about linear variables, we have found out the variables position, displacement, rate of change of displacement, rate of change of velocity. Now I am tracking with theta, so I should find out what is delta theta, what is rate of change of theta, which is omega, and what is rate of change of omega, which is alpha. Okay, the thing is that you have been dealing with the velocity, acceleration, and displacement since class 7th or 8th. Okay, that's why you're familiar to them. But this is no different from that scenario. Instead of displacement, you have delta theta. Instead of velocity, you have omega, angular velocity. Instead of acceleration, you have angular acceleration. All of you clear about it? Hold on. Coming to a direction, hold on, Himanshu. Is it clear whatever we have discussed just now? Is it clear? Is valid only if speed is changing. If speed is not changing, alpha will be zero, at will be zero, but radial acceleration will be there. Radial acceleration will be u square by r whether speed is changing or not. Now tell me, what is the SI unit of delta theta? Everyone, delta theta, what is the SI unit? Radians. Radians. What is the SI unit of omega? Omega, how should you write? Radians for angle, radians per second for angular velocity, and what about angular acceleration? Radians per second square. This is angular acceleration. Fine. These are the SI units, right? I hope there is no doubts here. I'll just ask you a simple question here, then we'll proceed. Suppose there is a alpha and omega are the vectors. Yes, alpha and omega are the vectors, and they are the direction is along the axis. Along the axis. Okay. If it is clockwise, you can take it as negative. Anti-clockwise, you can take it as positive. Hold on. Previous slide. This. Omega, alpha, and angular velocity. Oh, sorry. Omega, theta, and alpha. Take anti-clockwise positive, clockwise negative. Okay, that way you can take care of their directions. Okay, all right. Now suppose the speed is, suppose there is a circular motion going on with angular velocity omega, angular acceleration is alpha. At any moment, at a particular moment, angular velocity was omega and angular acceleration was alpha. The radius of the circular motion is r. You need to tell me the direction of the acceleration at this point. At the bottom point, what is the direction of total acceleration? All of you do this. Let me know once you're done. You have to show the direction of total acceleration. What is the direction of total acceleration in this case? No one. Tell me direction of the centripetal acceleration. Which direction? Centripetal acceleration will be in this way. What is the magnitude of centripetal acceleration? Anyone? Centripetal acceleration is u square by r, right? What is u in terms of omega? What I can write u in terms of omega? Look at your notes. U is what? R omega. So R omega whole square divided by R. So this is omega square R. Okay. And what about tangential acceleration? There will be tangential acceleration also. How much? This is omega square R. This is alpha into R alpha. So total acceleration will be what? This is 90 degree, right? Total acceleration will be vector sum of these two accelerations. Okay, so direction of total acceleration will be this. I hope all of you clear about it. Anyone has any other doubt? Is it clear? If there is a tangential acceleration, you need to account for that as well. Okay. Anyone has any doubts? I'm waiting still. Quickly ask. Shashwat, is it clear? Direction of alpha will also change with theta, right? No. Alpha and omega and theta, they are either clockwise or anti-clockwise. So alpha will remain anti-clockwise. Omega will remain anti-clockwise. Okay. How acceleration is along the tangent? That is tangential acceleration. Tangential acceleration is along the tangent. Radial acceleration is towards the center. Alpha is not along the tangent. Alpha is not. Alpha into r, tangential acceleration is along the tangent. Alpha is the anti-clockwise direction. Actual direction is when you curl your fingers like that, thumb is the direction of alpha, which is coming towards you from the axis. That is the direction of alpha. Tangential acceleration has to increase the speed. So tangential acceleration should be in the direction of speed only. Otherwise, how it will change the speed? Got it? Okay. Fine. So till now we have introduced theta, omega, and alpha. It is like introducing what is displacement, what is velocity, and what is acceleration. But until this, you get a relation. For example, previously we had a relation v is equal to u plus at, s equal to ut plus half at square. Until as you get a relation among theta, omega, and alpha, all these definitions are useless. Every time I have to tell you what is theta, what is omega, and what is alpha, you will not be able to analyze it. Okay, so now let us try to find out what is a relation among these variables, alpha, theta, and omega. Okay. So write down angular variables. Linear variables. Your school started, right? YPR school has started 8 a.m. to 1 p.m.
From tomorrow, sir.
Tomorrow. And what about the other? HSR? HSR starts tomorrow. YPR also tomorrow. Okay. But in HSR, it is 8:30 to 3 p.m., right? In YPR, it is 8 to 1 p.m. only. So angular variables. Delta theta correspond to displacement S. Omega corresponds to velocity. Corresponding variables. Okay. Alpha corresponds to acceleration. They are similar variables. Okay. And by definition, you can write down omega as d theta by dt. Here you can write down velocity is ds by dt. Then you can write down alpha is d omega by dt. Here you can write down acceleration as rate of change of velocity. Okay. Then for constant acceleration, mathematically we have solved these equations, these differential equations. If you solve it, you will be getting v is equal to u plus at, s equal to ut plus half at square, and v square equal to u square plus 2as. For constant acceleration, you get these three equations. Now, do mathematics know? I mean, does mathematics care whether you're writing omega instead of u, or s instead of theta, alpha instead of a, or u instead of omega? Mathematics is blind. Mathematics doesn't care. So if for these equations, you get this solution. So for constant angular acceleration, what should you get? Write down, all of you, your own. Done? Instead of u, omega is there. Instead of s, theta is there. So the first equation will be what? Omega is equal to initial angular velocity plus what? Are you able to understand? Okay, alpha into t. What about a second equation? What should I write? Instead of s, what should I write? Delta theta, right? Amount of angle covered is equal to omega naught t plus half alpha t square. What about the last equation? Omega square equal to omega naught square plus 2 alpha delta theta. But these equations are valid only if angular acceleration is a constant. Okay. Now, what if angular acceleration is not constant? Then what you will do? What you have done when A is not constant? We use calculus, right? When A was not constant, we have used differential equation and calculus to solve it. Similarly here, if alpha is not constant, you cannot use these three equations of motion. Rather, you have to use it directly, integrate it. Omega is d theta by dt. Okay, then you have alpha equal to d omega by dt. Any other differential equation you can think of? Alpha equal to? Any other differential equation that you can think of? No one? Correct. Just like acceleration can be written as v dv by ds. Remember that? Alpha can also be written as omega d omega by d theta. Fine. So do not hesitate to use these differential equations. Sometime alpha will be given in terms of time. Then you have to use this one. If alpha is given in terms of theta, use that one. Easy to integrate. Okay. And you will be understanding it more when you solve questions only. Just knowing it is not enough. Okay. Fine. So this is the basic concept. These are the basic concepts on how to analyze the circular motion. Getting it? How do we differentiate vectors? All these vectors are either in clockwise or anti-clockwise direction, upwards or downwards. So you just take care of it signs, okay? Make it a scalar. Okay. Details will be clearer when you solve questions. It is not a theoretical concept as such. Fine, let's take up questions only, right? Everyone, write down question number one. So an object is moving with angular velocity of 2 revolutions. I can write like this, 2 RPM, 2 revolutions per minute. No, it will be very slow, right? Let's keep it as 120 revolutions per minute. Okay, this is the angular velocity. What happens is it starts decelerating with angular acceleration of deceleration of 10 radians per second square. Sorry, not 10. Pi by 2 radians per second square. It starts decelerating. Okay. Now you need to find out how much angle it will rotate before coming to rest. Okay. How much angle delta theta it will rotate before coming to complete rest. This is 120 revolutions per minute. Okay, Hariharan got something. See, you need to convert it into SI units. RPM is not SI unit. What is the angular velocity, everyone, in SI units? One revolution is how many radians? Omega is given as 120 RPM. Okay. So one revolution is 2 pi radians. This much radians per minute. Now I have to find out how many radians per second. So that divided by 60. This much radians per second. So now you have converted it into the SI units. That is 4 pi radians per second. Okay. And hence now you can use the equations of motion. Constant deceleration. Constant. Which equation should I use to find delta theta before it comes to rest? Omega square equal to omega naught square plus 2 alpha delta theta. Correct? You can see this is very similar to motion in 1D. Okay? So I will just solve one or two questions. Then I think you will understand. It is very similar. Omega naught, omega is final velocity. It comes to rest. Omega becomes 0. Omega naught square is 4 pi square. Alpha is what here? What should I write instead of alpha? Minus pi by 2. So minus of 2 into pi by 2 delta theta. Fine. So angle it will rotate is how much? 16 pi radians. How many revolutions it will have before coming to rest? Before coming to rest, how many times it will revolve? This divided by 2 pi, right? This divided by 2 pi will be the number of revolution, because one revolution is 2 pi. All of you have understand, right? Raghuram A. Kumar, have you understood? Raghu? Raghuram?
Yes, sir.
Understood?
Sir, I'm having a lot of power issues. I don't know, sir.
Okay, it is getting recorded. Don't worry. Advik, have you understood? Advik, chalo. Arnav, is it clear? Rehan, Rohit, Shashwat, Buddha, Shreyas. Okay. Simple, right? If you keep things simple in your head, it will turn out to be a very simple problem. Okay, don't complicate things in your head. I'm again and again telling, it is exactly same as motion in 1D that you have just done. Fine. Next up, let's say angular velocity omega is, let's say 10 minus t square. Okay. You need to find out how much time it will take for the particle to stop. How much time the particle will take before it stops? Yes, Anurag, how much time this particle will take before it stops for the first time? Okay. Great. Himanshu got it. It was a straightforward question. What is the condition for it to stop? How many of you started integrating and differentiating? It's not required. Omega should be zero. Just put 10 minus t squared to be zero. That is the condition. Omega should be zero. Isn't it? So 10 minus t square, when it becomes zero, the particle will stop revolving. So t will come out to be under root of 10. Okay. Fine. Now tell me how much angle it will rotate before coming to rest. How much angle it will rotate before coming to rest in terms of radians? Can we use V is equal to U plus AT or S equal to UT plus half AT square? Everyone, can I use that? Can I use delta theta equal to omega naught T plus half alpha T square? Can I use it? The answer to that is no, I cannot use. The reason? Alpha is not constant. What is alpha? Differentiate omega. You'll get d omega by dt, which is alpha minus of 2t. It is function of time. Okay, you cannot use that equation. So you have to do something else. That something else is calculus, my dear friends. Do it. Okay, should I solve it? Fine. So all of you pay attention here. Omega can be written as d theta by dt. Because I cannot use the equation, I have to use the differential form. 10 minus t square. So d theta is equal to 10 minus t square dt. Okay. So from here, you'll get 10 dt minus t square dt. So when you integrate this d theta, now t will be from 0 to root 10. T you already found out before it stops. 0 to root 10. 0 to root 10. You find out from 0 to whatever angle it has rotated, delta theta. So delta theta is 10 into root 10 minus 1/3 of t cube, okay, which is 10 to the power 3 by 2. All right. So, so it will be 2/3 of 10 to the power 3 by 2 radians. Everybody understood this? Any doubts, please ask quickly. What is the doubt? Integrate delta theta. D theta integral is theta only. Last step, integral is 10 dt. 10 dt is 10 into t. Then putting upper limit and lower limit, root 10. So 10 root 10 minus t square dt integral is t cube by 3. So 1 by 3 comes. Then limits will be 0 to root 10. Okay, when to use integration, it's up to, it is your knowledge, okay, or it comes with the practice. Nobody can teach you that, okay, fine, now you should use integration. And this is how you have to use. You can still understand when to use integration, but how to use it, you will understand with the practice only. Okay, you have to solve questions, assignments, and then only you will understand how to. All right, okay, let's see whether I have any more question on it. Try this one. This one is a simple problem, okay? Everyone should be able to solve it, your own. Okay, I'll tell you the answer. I'm waiting. You guys continue solving. Prateek, you need to put it as a number. What is that? Yeah, that is fine, Prateek. Everyone, solve this question, all of you. It is going with constant speed. It is given that it is moves steadily. Okay, 7 revolutions in 100 seconds. So how many radians? 7 into 2 pi radians in 100 seconds. 14 pi by 100 radians per second is the angular velocity. Okay, what is linear velocity? How to find linear velocity? You got omega. So how to get linear velocity? Omega into r, right? You have learned that omega into r, multiply that with radius, 14 pi by 100 into 0.12, which is equal to how much? Velocity will come out to be 5.3 into 10 raised to power minus 2 meter per second. Okay. Now, what is the acceleration? How to get acceleration? Is there a tangential acceleration here, everyone? Is there tangential acceleration? There is only radial acceleration. How much is that? U square by R. So use it. (5.3×10⁻²) whole square divided by the radius, which is 0.12. How much it is? Have you calculated? How much it is? (2.3×10⁻²) meter per second square. You're not able to do this one? Are you finding cerebral motion difficult, everyone? Is it difficult? Do you want to solve one more question? Is it difficult or simple, everyone? Difficult. Okay, more questions. This one. Okay, I can see many answers people are getting. Should I tell you the answer? Pranav, what you got? Pranav and Arav, what are you doing? What did you get? Answer is 3:1. I can see many of you have got it. 6:2 is 3:1 only. Fine. So a wheel is subjected to a uniform angular acceleration about its axis. Initially, angular velocity is 0, so omega naught is 0. in first 2 seconds, it rotates by an angle of theta 1. So naturally, you will use this delta theta is equal to omega naught t plus half alpha t square. Fine. So first 2 seconds, I'm assuming that it starts from, yeah, it is given actually, it starts from rest. So delta theta in first 2 seconds is half alpha into 2 square. Okay. In next 2 seconds, it rotates additional angle delta theta 2. So let's call it as theta 1. Now, how to get next 2 seconds, how much it rotates? In total 4 seconds, it will rotate theta 1 plus theta 2, right? Next 2 seconds is this. This one will be half alpha into 4 square. All of you understand? These are the two equations. Everyone? It rotates additional delta theta 2 in additional 2 seconds. So total angle will be theta 1 plus theta 2 in 4 seconds. Is it not clear? Okay. So theta 2 will be equal to half alpha 4 square minus half alpha 2 square. Fine. So this will be half alpha 4 plus 2 into 4 minus 2. Okay. So you'll get it as 6 alpha theta 2. Theta 1 is equal to 2 alpha. So theta 2 by theta 1 is 3:1, right? Should we take one more? Should we solve more questions or move ahead? Till the break, let's continue with the circular motion. Okay, anyway, 4:30 will take a break. These two, I hope you can read it. Is it readable? You're able to read it, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, do it. Okay, I can see two people have answered already. Others, direction of angular velocity will be constant. Final answer. Let me see. Correct. Charan got it. Charan is very quiet today. What happened? Suddenly, Charan becomes very sincere student. All right, so yes, the answer, let me take a poll since I have the poll with me. All of you, take the poll for the two questions. All right. For the first one, answer is C, as majority is saying, and the second one, answer is A, again the majority. Let's see. Particle is moving in circular path with an acceleration of A. If velocity gets doubled, find the ratio of acceleration after and before the change. So we are assuming velocity is constant. Acceleration is what? Velocity square by r, radius is fixed. So a1 is proportional to v1 square, a2 is proportional to v2 square. So a1 by a2 is 1:4. But then here, after and before ratio is asked. After is a2, before is a1. Okay, so that is why 4:1. See, 1:4 is also there in option. So you, if you are in a hurry, you'll pick 1:4. A particle is, next one. A particle is moving along a circular path with uniform speed. Through what angle does the angular velocity change when it completes the half the circular path? Okay. Half the circular path is this. From here, this is the initial velocity, this is the final velocity, right? So through what angle does it angular velocity, or it's angular velocity, not the velocity. Angular velocity direction remains fixed, which is towards you. This anti-clockwise. So it remains fixed. So there is no change in direction in the angular velocity. Now, can you tell me what is the change in the direction of the linear velocity? What is the angle change in linear velocity? 180 degrees, correct. Last two questions on circular motion, then we'll start something new. Hope it is readable. Are we done with? Yeah, we had done. didn't understand the first one. What two bodies, concentric radius r, small r, time periods are same, the ratio between the centripetal acceleration. What is the doubt here? What exactly is the doubt? So what? Masses are given. Why are you getting confused with it? You know the formula, right? Don't worry about additional information given. This is how JEE exams are. They will confuse you with unnecessary information also at times. I can tell you these two bodies are in the moon or in Jupiter. Then you will start wondering why they are in Jupiter. Okay? I'll put a poll. Charan is requesting for the poll. हाँ, पोल आ रहा है, रुक जा. ओके, हियर इज द पोल. पीपल आर गेटिंग इम्पेशेंट. हियर इज द पोल, ले लो. ओके, टेक द पोल. All right, so I'll end the poll now. Only one person hasn't taken the poll. Charan hasn't taken. All right, so this is the poll result. It is completely mixed, you know, the first question, there's a confusion between A and B. A and B, okay. So, now, here is the thing, guys. When they say that ratio between centripetal acceleration, you don't know whether it is the first one divided by the second one or the second one divided by the first one. Then you have to always take first one divided by the second one. Okay? By default, it is first by second. Second question, there is a big confusion, I think. All A, B, C, D, people have been giving equal weightage. So let's see what are the answers now. First one, radius R, capital R and small r, their periods are same. Is it written their velocities are same? Their velocities need not be same. Their time period are same. Time period is what? Time period is 2 pi r divided by the velocity. Okay, so velocity is what? 2 pi r by t. Acceleration is v square by r. So this will be 2 pi r the whole square divided by t square into r. So you can see that acceleration comes out to be proportional to the radius. All right. Fine. This is the first acceleration. Second acceleration will be proportional to small r similarly. So a1 by a2 is capital R divided by the small r. So I hope you have understood there was a twist in the question. Some of you might have assumed that velocity is constant, but it is written time period is constant. So you need to get the velocity in terms of time period if you are comparing. Okay? Clear to everyone? The first question. Second one, I am doing it now. Car is moving along a circular path of radius 500 meters with a speed of 30 meters per second. Speed increases at a rate of 2 meters per second. So what is this? 2 meters per second square is what? Tangential acceleration. Tangential acceleration is given to you guys. 2 meters per second square. Okay. Then at that instant, magnitude of resultant acceleration, they are asking you to find out. So let's say at that instant, the particle is here. It will have a centipeter acceleration. How much? U square by R. And tangential acceleration is 2 meter per second square. So anybody got U square by R? How much it is? 30 square by 500. This is 9 by 5, right? 9 by 5 meter per second square. So how to get the resultant now? This 90 degree resultant of these two vectors will be? Magnitude will be what? 9 by 5 is 1.8 meter per second square. Sum of the squares of the whole root. Okay. So this will be equal to root over 2 square plus 1.8 whole square. Fine. This is what? This is 4 plus 1.8 whole square is what? 1.8 whole square. 3.24. So this is roughly under root of, roughly, yeah, exactly. 7.24. Hold on. Don't message. Root 7.24. So this cannot be 3 because 3 square is 9. Cannot be this, cannot be that. So this will be equal to D. Fine. So you don't need to find out what is square root of 7.24. After getting it, just evaluate with the option which one could be root of 7.24. Okay, so that's it with respect to circular motion. All of you have understood. Is there any doubt still? If not, we'll take a break. Clear to everyone? All right, so circular motion won't leave you. When we'll be doing rigid body motion, circular motion will come again with full flow. And that is considered to be the most difficult chapter. There, the circular motion will be like a big object rotating. So each and every point will be rotating in a circle. That will take care later on. Okay, not now. Fine. So right now, let's take a break now. We will meet after 15 minutes. So currently it is 4:40. We will meet at 4:55 p.m. Okay, this is the break. Yes, resultant means sum, vector summation.
Just give me one more minute, guys. Okay, so all of you there, we can start. I hope you guys have understood how to deal with the circular motion. You have to just practice a few more questions and then it will be perfect. Okay. You can hear me, right? Am I audible clearly? Okay. Fine. So next topic that we are going to take up is relative motion in 2D. Write down. Okay, so relative motion in 2D, as the name suggests, it is the motion in a plane only, but there are two objects that are moving here. Fine. What happened? What do you want, Pranav? We are doing something else. Projectile motion we'll do later on, not now. Okay, fine. So all of you focus here. So relative motion in 2D, it is a concept very similar to relative motion in 1D. But here, it is not like motion 1D, where both observer and the object, both are along one straight line only, right? In motion 1D, relative motion. But in relative motion in 2D, observer can be moving like this. And object can be moving like that. Fine. So both the velocities need not be in a single straight line. So this is what we are going to analyze here. Fine. But the basic concept remains the same, which we will write. The observer, write down, observes. Observer observes the world after subtracting her own velocity from objects. Okay. So when we subtract, whether we should subtract their magnitude or we should subtract vectorially. What do you think? Any guesses? Correct. We need to subtract like a vector. Vector subtraction should be there. Okay. Vector subtraction. Fine. So let's take example, a simple example we'll take. Let's say a person is going like this. This is velocity of the observer. Okay. There is an object that coming down like that. This is, let's say, V2. So can you tell me how this person will see this object falling down? In what direction it will see, how it will be, everyone? The observer will see the relative velocity, which is V2 minus V1. Towards the center. Where is the center? The observer, which has velocity V1, okay, won't be able to see V2. Observer, which is moving with V1, will be seeing relative velocity, which is what? The object's velocity minus observer's velocity. So observer will subtract everything with its own velocity and then look at the world. Okay, so like this it will be. So V1 is like this, V2 is like that. So I need to add minus V1 to V2. So what should I do? This is V2. Minus V1 is this. Opposite direction. This is minus V1. So V2 minus V1 will be, I'll be completing the triangle like that. Fine. So this is the way observer will feel the object is coming. Now I'll tell you the real life example here. So when you guys, have you ever ran with the umbrella when it is raining, or you sat in the bike while it is raining? Although that is very dangerous. Don't try doing that, sitting in a bike in a rain with an umbrella. Okay. So when you run with an umbrella and rain is coming down, you keep umbrella like this or you slightly tilt it forward? What do? You tilt it forward. Is the rain coming forward or rain is coming down? Rain is coming down, but why you tilt it forward? There's no wind. Forget about wind. There is no wind. Why you tilt it when you're running? And faster you run, more you have to tilt or not? Faster you run, more you have to tilt. Okay. The reason is when you are running, you're not seeing the true velocity of the rain. It will appear to you as if rain is coming like that towards you like this. So you have to tilt in that direction. So you have to tilt in the relative velocity direction. Okay. Sometime rain coming slanted, not vertical. No, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a normal scenario. Why observer won't be able to see the object? Observer is able to see the object, but observer himself is moving now. So velocity will be different. Velocity will be different. It is like this. Suppose you are in a train. Train is moving. So you'll feel as if trees are going back, right? Trees are going back against your motion. Similarly here also. But that was motion in 1D. Everything was happening in one straight line. Here it is motion in 2D. Okay. Is it clear, Himanshu?
observer, if it is running with V1, observer will not feel as if the rain is falling vertically down. Observer will feel that rain is coming towards it in a slanted direction. This is what it means. It will see that rain is coming in this direction, which is the blue line. So the observer won't see the object, how it is actually moving. Yes, that's what I'm saying. The actual motion of the object won't be able to, observer won't be able to see it. Because observer is running while looking at it. Okay. Any other doubt? Anyone? Please ask all your doubts. When we cross the river, when there is a current, that is a different thing. We'll talk about it. River boat questions. Any other doubt? No one? If I am running through rising steam, the direction will be opposite. What are you saying? Not able to get you. Acceleration, it will be separate, right? Yeah, acceleration will be dealt like this only, separately. If observer is accelerating like this, you have to draw the diagram for acceleration also. Acceleration has nothing to do with velocity. Okay. Clear? All right. So I think let's discuss the river current situation now itself. Why to wait, all of you? So there will be one very common scenario which has to do with the river boat problems. Fine. So there will be situations in which it will be like this. A river is going like this. This is velocity of river. Okay. And there will be a lot of things happening here. Observer is going forward, then coming backward. Swimmer is there. So we need to understand how to analyze this kind of scenario also. Okay. So if you are a swimmer, let's say, okay, if you are a swimmer, you are trying to go like this. You're trying to go like this. What will happen to you? Anurag, no nonsense. Otherwise you leave it. Go. What will happen? You are trying to go like this. You'll also move with the current, right? But is the swimmer making any effort to move with the current? Swimmer is making any effort or not? Swimmer is not making any effort. Okay. So the total velocity will be what? The effort what swimmer is making, plus effort what the this thing river is making. So let's say velocity of river is VR. Total velocity will be what? Total velocity will be sum of these two velocities. It will be like this. So observer will feel that as if observer is going straight. But then in reality, what happens is the drift velocity, this is the velocity of the river, gets added to it. Observer goes slant like that. Okay. This is a true velocity. This is what observer tries to do. This is what river tries to do. So both efforts get added up. Fine. What will be the total velocity? Root over whatever is the velocity of the river square plus velocity of the observer square. Observer or the swimmer. Now tell me, what is the velocity of the swimmer with respect to the river? With respect to river, what is the relative velocity of the swimmer? Everyone. v resultant minus no, you are finding out with respect to observer. I am asking you with respect to river. With respect to river, it will be what? Total velocity minus velocity of river, or velocity of observer minus velocity of river. Which one? A or B? Which one do you think? Look at what is written, the first line in this page. What is written? Observer sees the world after subtracting his or her own velocity from the actual velocity. What is the actual velocity? V naught or Vt? Which one is actual velocity? Vt is the actual velocity, right? The total velocity of the swimmer is Vt. That is the actual velocity. From that, you need to subtract the reverse velocity, which is Vr. So what do you get?
Sir, so is it actual velocity or the object's velocity? So because like an object, like for the river, the object is the person going.
Let me finish first. So like I said, it is actual velocity, right? Look at the first statement. All right. It is always the observer looks at the world after subtracting his or her own velocity. Here, who is the observer? River or the swimmer? Who is the observer? Tell me. Swimmer is the observer. Pranav, you're getting it? Who is the observer here? River is the observer. And swimmer's velocity is what? V naught or Vt? Now you speak, Pranav. What do you wanted to speak? Who was speaking? Arnav was speaking. Arnav, what was the doubt? Tell me.
No, sir, I got it. I just got confused that...
That is why I said, first let me complete my statement.
Yes, sir.
Right? So, again... Total velocity is Vt. Vt minus Vr is the relative velocity, which is what? V naught only. Which is V naught only, right? So what the swimmer is capable of, that is a relative velocity. Okay. The capability of the swimmer is a relative velocity, plus the capability of river is getting added on it to get the total velocity. Okay, I guess little bit of confusion is there. We'll take up questions and it'll be a lot more clearer, okay? Let's take up questions. We'll take the river questions only first. Suppose all of you draw a river like this. How do we know a swimmer is traveling faster or something? Hold on. Solve questions. Then many of the doubts go away when you take up the question. All right. This is anyway not a theory. Swimmer, boat, do you think it's a part of theory? No. Theory is just what is displacement, what is velocity, what is acceleration. Okay. Everything else is numerical only. So we are discussing numerical without even taking one numerical. So now take a question and realize what is happening. Suppose the width of the river is 100 meter. Write down. Width of the river is 100 meter. Okay. Now, a swimmer can swim. with a velocity of 2 meters per second. Okay, this is hypothetically 2 meters per second is the capability of the swimmer. All right. Then here, the velocity of river is 1 meter per second. The velocity of river is in this direction. This way. Okay. Okay. And swimmer is trying to move across as shown. This is how swimmer is trying to move. Fine. You need to tell me these things. Total velocity of the swimmer, B, time to cross the river, C, how much deviation, or what is A to B? What is A and B? A is a point right across from where it started. B is a point where he will land up. So what is the distance between A and B? Try it out. Okay, many things will be clear when we try this question itself. Okay, others? I can see many of you have answered. The true velocity will be what? Velocity of the person plus velocity of the river. So his actual velocity will be like this. Okay. So if I make a full triangle, this is the capability of the person. This is what the river is doing. This velocity plus that velocity is this one, the true velocity. Okay, good to see many of you have got the answer. So the true velocity is root over, this is 90 degree, right? So resultant will be
root over this velocity square plus that velocity square. So it will be 2 square plus 1 square, which is root 5 meter per second. Okay. Now, time to cross the river. Time to cross the river. How to get that? How to get it? This is a true velocity, right? Do I know displacement? Displacement is 100 in what direction? Displacement is given in this direction. In that direction, displacement is given, right? Do I know velocity in that direction? If this is theta, the component of velocity in this direction is what? Vr cos theta, which is this one only. That is 2 meter per second. So along that direction, along the direction of displacement, the direction or the magnitude of the velocity is 2. So time will be 100 divided by 2, which is 50 seconds. Now I need to find AB. AB is in which direction? AB is in that direction. In that direction, what is the velocity of the person? Which is Vr sine theta, that is 1 meter per second. So AB is 1 meter per second into 50 time. Okay, 1 into 50 seconds, that is 50 meters. Now tell me, is there any doubt in this particular question? Anyone has any doubts? Feel free to ask doubts, okay? Don't worry about. Didn't get the time. See, in order to find time, what we do, if it is moving with constant velocity, we take up distance by velocity, right? Distance by velocity is time, isn't it? So distance is 100, but 100 is not in the direction of velocity. So I have to find the velocity in the direction of displacement, which is 2 meter per second. So displacement is 100, velocity is 2. So time is 100 by 2. But suppose you know the displacement in that direction. Suppose you know what is this distance. Okay. If you know that distance, then you can as well, you know, do that distance divided by root 5. That will again come out to be 50 only. Okay. By the time this person goes from here to here, displacement in that direction should be 100. Velocity in that direction is 2. So time is 100 by 2. Okay. How is AB coming in? AB is what? Displacement in that direction. What is the velocity in that direction, Anurag? Velocity in this direction, 1 meter per second. And in what time? How much time you need that distance? By the time 50 seconds happens, it will be reaching there. So that velocity into 50 is 50 meters. Any other doubt? No doubts? Let's take up one more question on river and boat. One last question. So suppose the distance between the two banks of the river is 100 meter. Okay. There is this swimmer which can swim at a speed of 2 meter per second. Okay. The river has a velocity which is also 2 meter per second. The person wants to, the swimmer wants to move in a shortest path, in a shortest possible path to reach the other side. Find out how much time it will take. How much time it will take to swim velocity of river like this. Right. Which direction the total velocity should be? Tell me. The net velocity should be in what direction? Perpendicular to the flow, right? Perpendicular to flow, that is what the swimmer wants. Total velocity should be perpendicular to flow. It is not like earlier case. Fine. So the actual velocity should be in this direction. Okay. But I know the actual velocity, that is total velocity, is the what swimmer can do plus what river is doing. So this vector sum should be valid, right? So how to complete the triangle? This is the velocity of the river this way. Okay. So which direction the swimmer should try to move? What do you think? Which direction? Everyone try it. It should try to move like this. If it tries to move like that, river will add its velocity and it will become straight. Okay, so this is V naught. Okay. So what is this velocity then? Oh, sorry, this particular case cannot exist with these. Otherwise, the vertical velocity come out to be zero. Okay, let's take it as one. Take it as one. Okay. So now tell me what is the true velocity? Vt will be what? Use Pythagoras theorem. If you use Pythagoras theorem, V naught square is equal to Vr square plus Vt square, isn't it? So V naught square is 4, Vr square is 1 plus Vt square. So Vt is root 3 meter per second. Okay. Its total velocity is along the direction of the displacement, which is 100 meters. So time will be what? Everyone, t will be what? Hundred displacement divided by the velocity, 100 by root 3. So this is the time the swimmer will take if swimmer wants to go against a straight line across the bank in 90 degrees.
Yeah, I'll repeat it. But please ask doubts. What is your doubt? Don't tell me, repeat. What does it mean? Tell me what is your doubt. Everyone. What is your doubt, Weber? Shouldn't we not be towards the other side? Why? V0 plus VR should be VT. So if V0 is on that side, then if you add VR, it will become like this, further slant. This will be V total. And you don't want that. Why did you do it like the previous? Every case is different, Weber. And here also we have done that only. Look at the previous case, what we have done. Previous case, swimmer is trying to move. Swimmer is not actually moving in the 90 degree. Swimmer thinks that he is moving. Okay. And while it is moving, the river will drift along with it. And the total velocity becomes slanted. But over here, in this case, swimmer is smart. Swimmer knows that if he has to go in a straight line, he has to go in this way so that when drift of the river happens, its velocity will become straight. Okay, Weber.
Sir, I had a doubt.
Huh.
So for this question, will the deviation be zero or the length over here? Because sir, I didn't understand that.
Okay, tell me, will there be any deviation? Well, the swimmer will land up here only or somewhere over here or there? Where it will be?
So directly opposite.
So what is your doubt?
Sir, so is the deviation zero or is the deviation the length of AC?
I'm not getting, what is the doubt?
Sir, my doubt is that is the deviation, like for in this case, is the deviation zero or is the
what deviation? What is the definition of deviation?
The how much it has deviated from its original path.
So how much it is here?
The AC.
Zero,
nothing. Just adding, how is it zero?
Because the swimmer is going straight. His actual velocity is straight. Swimmer thinks that he is going slant. Swimmer is trying to go slant so that river takes him along in a straight line. Okay. He is supposed to go to sea. No, Hariharan. That is not... If suppose river is not flowing, river has zero velocity, then the swimmer will go to sea. Like that. Okay. Because that is what swimmer is trying to do. But if river is flowing along, then river velocity will get added to the velocity what swimmer is trying to do. So swimmer is trying to do like this. Velocity of the river will get added up. River will push it this way. Swimmer goes that way. So the velocity becomes straight then. Getting it? If river is at rest, it'll go like that. River has no effect then. See, swimmer is swimming on the water. Okay. The swimmer effort is apart from what water does. So swimmer effort plus the effort of the water is the total effect. Deviation is not AC. It's velocity. This is a total velocity. This is what. If a person is standing on the bank like this, this person will feel as if swimmer is going straight like this. Swimmer is trying to go like that. River will push it this way and swimmer velocity will become straight. So this person will feel as if swimmer is going straight along this path OA. Okay. So more than drift, we can call it X chord. Anything you call, but you have to define what do you mean by that? initial path was towards sea. Yeah, you can say that. He has started swimming towards sea. Started swimming. But then river velocity is also there. River will push it in this way. While he is swimming, river is also creating an effect. So velocity of river will get added up. Everybody understood? If river is flowing in the other direction, should the river should swim to B? Yes, that is very correct. If river is flowing like this, then swimmer has to go like that so that when velocity of the river gets added up, then it becomes straight. If river is going in other way. Okay, remember one very simple thing. The actual velocity is what swimmer is capable of plus what river is doing to the swimmer. This is the total velocity. All of you understood? Please type in yes or no. Otherwise, I'll not move forward. These are the river questions. There can be river boat questions also, river swimmer question also. There can be swimmer and boat both in the river. All right. But then I don't want to further complicate it. First, you need to do basic level of questions, get used to it, and then only I can complicate the situation further. Okay. But then I've enabled you so that you can try out any question, by the way. Now let's talk about the scenario. I mean, it's a very common question, which is like this, all of you. A person is there with an umbrella. This person is running with, let's say, 5 meters per second, which is higher than the, no, it is lesser than the Usain Bolt's speed. Usain Bolt is 9 meters per second, I guess. Anyways, who cares? So the person is running with 5 meters per second, right? There is rain coming vertically down. There's no wind, okay? There's a rain that comes vertically down with a speed of 3 meters per second, okay? 3 meters per second. You need to tell me which direction the person should tilt his camera so that, I mean, whatever. You have to find out which direction the person should tilt the umbrella, okay? For obvious reasons. Do we count acceleration due to gravity for the rain? No, no, no. Assume it is coming with a straight constant velocity. Okay. Opposite to the relative direction of rain. That's not how you answer. In physics, it should be quantitative. You should tell that angle should be tan inverse of this, like that. You have to basically find out which direction the person will see the rain coming down. Will the person see the actual velocity of rain or velocity of rain minus velocity of himself? What the person will see? Velocity of person is, let's say, Vp, and this is Vr. Person will see Vr, or the person will see Vr minus Vp. Which one? Which one this person will feel? Second one, right? Vr minus Vp, because the person is looking at the rain while running. So person is the observer who is observing the rain. So person or the observer will look at the world, each and everything, by subtracting his or her own velocity. So he has to subtract his own velocity from the velocity of the rain. Okay. So this is velocity of the person, 5 meters per second. This is velocity of the rain, 3 meters per second. So you need to invert it so that it becomes minus velocity of the person. And this is what is Vr minus Vp. So this is how it will feel the rain coming towards. Now, what is the magnitude of this velocity, everyone? With what magnitude the velocity will come towards the person? Root over 5 square plus 3 square, it is hypotenuse. So magnitude is this length square plus that length square under root. That is root 34. Okay. And this is the angle with the vertical, let's say theta. So tan of theta should be equal to 5/3. So angle with the vertical should be 5/3. Is it clear to everyone? The person will feel the rain is coming with a velocity of root 34 at an angle of tan inverse 5/3 from the vertical. Everyone is able to understand this? All of you? Shouldn't theta be the angle? Theta is angle only. What is the doubt? Theta is the angle, so that tan theta is 5/3. How do you find theta? Once you learn inverse trigonometric, you will understand theta is tan inverse of 5/3. Okay. Any other doubt? Should we solve more questions on these topics? Frankly speaking, this should not be part of theory. I'm just taking numericals and making you understand how to solve numericals. Okay, there is no theory as such. So let's take a few more questions. Solve this. make your judgment. See, this is not a good habit to ask about the question. Okay. Once you attempt it, your own judgment should be there. Otherwise, every time when you write exam, you'll be like, oh, somebody should explain me the question. Okay. Once you try it based on your judgment, then we'll discuss it. Okay, so I think many of you have tried already. All of you attempted? Nikhil, have you attempted? Okay. Fine, let us do this. First thing, again, I'm repeating, I think I've repeated that many a times. First thing to solve any physics question, draw the diagram. Okay. Doesn't matter how simple or difficult the question is. It's a matter of habit. 400 meter wide, the river is flowing at 2 meters per second. It is flowing with 2 meters per second. Boat is sailing at a velocity 10 meters per second with respect to water. Now it is given with respect to water. So it is like capability of the swimmer is given to you. This is the capability of the boat. This is what boat can do if there is no velocity of the river. Right? This is the this is the capability. When I say relative velocity, that is also capability. So on top of it, river can add its velocity. Fine. So capability of the boat, like that you should read. Capability of the boat is 10 meters per second. Okay. And it is moving in the direction perpendicular to river. And this direction is the direction of the relative velocity or direction of the actual velocity. It is given that it is sailing at a velocity of 10 meters per second with respect to the water in a direction perpendicular to river. So it is a relative velocity direction or actual velocity direction. Read it again. There is no hurry, okay? There is no hurry. Read it again. I'll read with you. A boat is sailing at a velocity of 10 meters per second with respect to water in a direction perpendicular to the river. So this direction is with respect to water or the actual velocity direction. This is the relative velocity direction because they are talking about velocity with respect to the river only, isn't it? So don't get confused in the words, okay? This is the relative velocity and this velocity is given to me. Relative velocity is the capability of the boat. Boat is trying to move like this with 10 meter per second. Okay. But will boat be able to do that? Will boat be able to move like that? Anyone? What will happen when boat is trying to move like this? The river will take it along. The river will add its own velocity onto what boat is trying to do. So total velocity will be in this way. This will become the total velocity. Fine. So, this is the total. What is the magnitude of total velocity? Root over 10 square plus 2 square. Okay, which is root over 104 meter per second. All right. Time taken by the boat to reach the opposite bank. So what is the component of, okay, all of you, this is the actual velocity, okay? This red line is the true velocity. So if you want to find the component, you have to find component of the true velocity. So component of this red line velocity, which is the true velocity, in the direction of 400 meter displacement is what? What is the component of the true velocity in the direction of displacement? In the direction of 400 meters displacement, what is the component of velocity? Let's say this is theta. Total velocity times cos theta, which is 10 only. Hypotenuse times cos theta is base, which is 10. Okay, so time is what? Displacement divided by 10, which is 40 seconds. Okay. How far this one? B part. I think something like this we did. B part, how to do? Second is moved with what velocity in this way? 2 meter per second. 2 meter per second, right? This component of velocity is 104 sine theta, which is perpendicular only. And this is 2 meter per second. It is 2 meters per second. So that's the best thing because there is a right angle triangle. Okay. So you can take components. So 2 into 40. That is 80 meters. Okay. Everybody understood this? Type in whatever doubts you have. Quickly ask doubts. No doubts? Okay, we'll go to the next question now. All right, so let's take up this one. Draw a equilateral triangle. This is an equilateral triangle. Fine. Vertex 1, vertex 2, and 3. Okay. So particles 1, 2, and 3 starts to move with constant speed in such a manner that one always towards two always tries to move towards three, and three always tries to move towards one. Okay, so what will happen is, this kind of motion will appear. they will basically converge. Okay, they will converge, and the every time included triangle will be there, and with time they will converge and meet at the centroid, like that. So you need to find out how much time it will take for them to meet, how much time it will take for these particles to meet. Okay, side length is A. Side length of the equilateral triangle is A. Constant speed U. It's not a straightforward question, okay? It's very tricky, but let's see whether we can solve this. All of you tried? Everyone? Should I solve it now? Okay, listen here. Take only 2 points, 1 and 2. So, by the time 1 meets 2, 2 will meet 3, isn't it? So now tell me, initially 1 is going towards 2, isn't it? This is the velocity u, and 2 is going towards 1, so 2 is going towards 3, like that. This is u. Okay, now here is a trick. Suppose 2 is the observer. Suppose 2 is the observer. How it will see 1? 1 is continuously coming towards 2, isn't it? So relative velocity of approach. Velocity of approach for 1. Can you write down what it is? Velocity of approach. This is 60 degrees. U plus U cos 60. All of you agree? component of velocity along the line joining is u cos 60. Like that. Fine. Everyone understand or not? No? See, you need to find out the velocity of approach along the line joining 1 and 2. Along the line joining. So you have to take velocity along the line joining 1 and 2. Fine? So the one's velocity is along the line joining only. That is u. The velocity of 2 is like that. So you have to take its component along the line joining, which is u cos 60. So u cos 60 from here and u from there. So total velocity of approach is what? U plus u cos 60. Are you getting it? Fine. Distance of approach is what? Distance of approach is a that divided by the velocity of approach is the time. So the answer is 2a by 3u. So again, you have seen the power of the velocity of approach concept here. Fine. No role of 3. You can take any two points. You can take 3 and 1 also. Same thing will come. It is a symmetrical case. Whatever happens between 1 and 2, same thing happens between 2 and 3. Same thing happens between 3 and 1. So that is why. Angle remains 60 degrees because of the symmetry. The equilateral triangle is there. It will rotate. While rotating, it will become smaller and smaller and then it coincides. Why did you take cos? Because I have to take velocity of approach along the line joining 1 and 2. So I have to take component of the velocity of 2 because total velocity is not along 1 and 2. Total velocity makes angle theta. So when you take the component, you have found out the velocity along the line joining. Again, this is not a very easy question to understand just like that. It takes a lot of practice. You know, ideally, I do not give this question when I teach it, when I introduce a concept, because you guys have not done the basic practice on this chapter. So once you do the basic practice, then you'll start understanding these kind of questions also. I have a lot of questions. I'll send you the homework. And if you want more, you just text me. I'll send you more. Do this. No, Anurag, that you can't do. See, when what Anurag is saying is we know that point number one goes to a centroid only. So you find the distance from its centroid and divide by its velocity. But Anurag, it is not going in a straight line to the centroid. It is taking a curved path. You don't know the length of that path. Fine. That is why taking a relative velocity concept, because relatively it appears that distance of approach is only A. Distance of approach is A. But in reality, they are traveling in curved paths. Displacement will be in that direction, but velocity keeps on changing. Velocity is not constant. That direction of velocity keeps on changing, Anurag. Do this. Once we are done with circular and relative motion, you'll see in projectile motion also we can mix up all of this. Okay, Himanshu, got something? Others? 10. Himanshu, you did not get in terms of theta. Independent of theta. Answering part A or part B? Different answers people are giving. Still looks like concepts are not very clear. So it's okay. Just keep on trying. We'll take up questions. And these are not simple questions. So it is okay if you're not able to solve in the first attempt itself. Okay. Should I attempt or should I wait? Okay, I'm attempting it. This distance. Are you finding this chapter difficult, everyone? Are you finding it difficult? Not much. Okay, so see the previous chapter you already did in class 9th. So it was familiar to you. This chapter you have never, done. So that is why you're finding little bit uneasiness. But then the truth is, this chapter is simpler than the previous chapter. That is the truth. So if you just practice little bit more, you'll be a lot comfortable with these concepts. Okay. Fine. Swimmer wishes to cross 500 meter wide river flowing at 5 km/h. His speed with respect to water. What is given? Capability of the swimmer is given. That is a relative velocity. That is what swimmer can do. Okay. If he heads in the direction making angle theta with the flow, find the time takes to cross the river. Now, in part A, is angle theta given for its relative velocity or for its true velocity? actual or the relative velocity? Okay. Suppose it is not written. It is not written whether it is actual velocity or relative velocity. So then what you should assume? If it is given velocity is 2 meters per second, forget about this question. If it is given velocity is 2 meters per second, should you assume that to be real velocity or relative velocity? What is a normal practice? The real velocity, actual velocity, right? If I just say that velocity is this, you have to assume it is a real velocity. If I do not mention that it is relative velocity, then you have to assume it is the actual velocity. Got it? So actual velocity makes an angle theta with the flow. Fine. The flow velocity is this. And the person is, let's say, flowing, going like that. This is the actual velocity. Fine. And it makes angle theta with the flow direction. This is the direction of flow. So where is the angle? You have to extend it. This is the angle theta. Angle between the two vectors. You have to connect them tail to tail. Fine. Find the time it takes to cross the river. Fine. Now, in order to do that, I know the displacement is 500 meter, but do I know the direction of, displacement is 500 meter, but which direction my velocity is? Velocity direction is like that. Okay. Fine. So I need to find out its velocity in that direction. Fine. In this direction, I need to find its velocity. So how much is that? This is 180 minus theta. This is 90. This one is 180 minus theta. So 180 minus theta plus 90 plus phi should be equal to 180. So phi is 90 minus theta. So this is 90 minus theta. Okay. Yeah, it need not be 90. I'm asking what is the velocity in that direction. What's the velocity in that direction? Because displacement is known in that direction. If actual velocity is given to you, let's say V actual is given to you is VA, then it will be what? VA cos of 90 minus theta, right? This one will be VA sine theta. This is the velocity in the direction of displacement. So time it should take is 500 divided by VA sine theta. What is VA given to us? No, it is not given to us. Should be given to us. Either it should be given to us. VA sine theta need not be equal to 3, right? It need not be equal to 3. Because the vector, no. VA is 3, you're saying. His speed with respect to what? Now, then you are assuming in part A, they are saying that it is angle with the relative velocity. Okay, if you're saying that VA is 3, you're assuming in part A, they mean to say that the angle theta is with the relative velocity. All right, which is not true. Or they should have clearly mentioned that relatively he is moving, or at least they should write that the person feels that he is going at an angle theta, which is not actually the case, but he thinks that he is going at that angle. Even that is not very clear here. But then just for the solving this question, let's say we write here that if he feels that he is moving in a direction of angle theta, then I can say that this is the relative velocity. Okay, this is not the actual velocity. Just for the sake of completion, we have modified the question a bit. In part A, we are saying that the person feels that he is going at an angle theta with the flow. So this relative velocity is given to us. A swimmer is going with 3 km/h. So this is 3. Okay. So now VA is 3 and this makes an angle theta. So this direction, the velocity is 3 sine theta. So like this, you can get it. Uh, 500 meter into convert in the kilometers also. 0.5 kilometers. Okay. Some issue with the question here, not clearly written. We'll just take up another question. Okay. Basics of projectile, you know, right? Basics of, because there is a question which includes projectile motion also. So you have anyway taken a test today. Till when the class will be? Class is till 6:30. I messaged, na? It was 3 p.m. to... No, wait. What is the timing of class? 2:30 to 6. Oh God. Sorry guys. Sorry. So we'll stop now. No, you never told me that class is over. Time is over. All right, guys. So, all right. Sorry for extending the class. You guys can take up the questions as homework. Fine. Oh, you thought that I will scold. I don't scold like that. All right, guys, so take this as homework. I will, send this thing across. So we'll see you next week. Bye for now. Take care.